Michael Marriott of the Nuclear Information and Resource Service about the state of nuclear power today, next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman, on location at the Northeast Action Camp for a nuclear-free world with Michael Marriott, Executive Director of the Nuclear Information and Resource Service. Michael, your group is based in Washington. It's the prime watchdog group, informational group concerning atomic power in the United States. The state of nuclear power today.
The nuclear industry reminds me of the last dinosaur flailing away because it's a dying industry virtually across the entire world, with a couple of exceptions I'll get to in a moment. But there are no nuclear plants being built in the United States, and there haven't been any new plant orders in over 20 years. There are no nuclear plants being built in Canada. There are no new plant orders anywhere in Western Europe. The nuclear industry is, in fact, reversing itself. Instead of new nuclear plants, we're seeing the shutdown in the West of older nuclear plants. The only place where the nuclear industry is vibrant, and perhaps that's not the right word, but is moving ahead, is a few countries in Asia, with particular concern about China, which is embarking on a modernization program of its economy overall, and currently feels that nuclear has a place in that. We believe at NIRS that China will end up making many of the same mistakes that the United States and Western Europe made 20 years ago, spending billions of dollars and getting very little in return, and they don't seem to have learned from that. And of course, the nuclear industry, its lobbyists worldwide, not just US, but worldwide, are trying their best to make sure that China does foolishly spend this money. But closer to home in the United States, we're seeing an increasing, sort of a contradiction term, but an increasing decline, an accelerating decline of the nuclear power industry. In the 1990s alone, a number of nuclear plants have closed. Four in New England, for example, Yankee Row, Millstone 1, Maine Yankee, Connecticut Yankee. We've had two reactors close in Illinois, the Zion reactors. We've had Trojan close in Oregon. Rancho Seco in California closed in 1989. San Onofre in California closed in the 90s. We were, at one point, in 1974, then President Richard Nixon said there would be 1,000 nuclear reactors operational in the United States by the year 2000. 450 days away from that today, we will have less than 100.
Now, towards the end of the 90s, the big argument the nuclear industry, nuclear establishment, has for nuclear power is the global warming issue, that nuclear power plants don't increase global warming as fossil fuel plants do. The reply to that?
Well, the nuclear industry is fond of saying that nuclear power plants don't produce emissions. What they mean by that is that they don't produce carbon dioxide emissions. Nuclear power plants do have emissions. They emit strontium-90, they emit cesium-137, they emit tritium, they emit some of the most hazardous elements known to the planet on a routine basis. These are emissions, they're just not the same emissions. You don't trade one environmental disaster for another, and that's what you have. We agree, global warming is a serious issue. It needs to be addressed, but the way it needs to be addressed is economically, and that in itself means increased energy efficiency, increased reliance on renewable resources, and it needs to be addressed from an environmental perspective. And that also means no nuclear energy. It means, again, energy efficiency. It means wind power. It means solar power. And to some degree, at least in the near term, probably a somewhat greater reliance on natural gas is a bridge fuel. And that we need to continually improve our energy efficiency technologies, which are continually evolving and improving, and continue to get the cost of renewables down. Wind energy already is competitive, much of the country, with any other source of power, and solar is rapidly getting there. But the analogy I like to use for the emissions is this. If radiation were the color and texture of oil, and you could see it coming out of the plants the way it does every day, nobody would ever again talk about the concept of nuclear power plants have no emissions.
After many years of challenging nuclear technology, nuclear power, you took a visit to the former Soviet Union. After many years of warning about nuclear catastrophe, severe nuclear plant accidents, you were there at the scene at the Chernobyl nuclear plant site. What did you see? How did it perhaps change what you know and feel about nuclear technology?
Well, I think I did go to Chernobyl in 1996 for a conference on the 10th anniversary, international conference. And following that, I did take a visit to the plant itself, to the surrounding area. It's quite moving. It's sort of a visual definition of the apocalypse in some ways. You go there, and you know, I've also been to Berlin in the old days with the Berlin Wall. It was designed to keep people in. But when you enter the dead zone around Chernobyl, it's a zone about 18-mile radius. It's not the only abandoned zone, but it's the official dead zone. And you see a checkpoint, and it looks like the old Berlin checkpoints, and it's designed to keep people out of this zone rather than to keep them in. But it's a very similar type of thing. And then you drive through just miles and miles of nothing, off to the side of the road or some abandoned houses. There's several places where there are just enormous quantities of vehicles and things like helicopters and buses just stacked up, rusting on the side of the road. And these are, in fact, radioactive waste dumps. All of these materials were too hot and remain too hot to do anything else with. They're just sitting there. And you drive on. We went to the town of Chernobyl, which is 12 miles from the plant, and met with some of the local officials. And there, and that's where people who work at the plant and cleaning up the area and monitoring the area live. They're allowed to live there for 2 weeks, and then they have to leave the area some distance for 2 weeks, and then they can come back again. Because the radiation exposures are too high to be there permanently. And then we went up to a decontamination center and, you know, changed clothes. We came in on a bus, and they won't let you take that bus any further. You have to get on a different bus that can also go no further the other way, because every step you take, the contamination levels are just higher and higher when you change into protective clothing. And we went, you know, up to the plant. The radiation levels were, you know, extremely high. But I think the most moving thing was touring the city of Pripyat, which is a city really built to house the Chernobyl workforce and all the support that went into that. It was a city of nearly 50,000 people. And now it's a city of nobody. There's weeds growing through the streets. There's the buildings are still there. It's mostly apartment buildings. The owners' possessions inside those buildings are still there, but the owners aren't there. The residents aren't there. And you walk, and there's a large town square. You can see where there once were some stores that are empty now. There's a little further on, there's a carnival that happened to be set up that day, a traveling carnival type thing, a merry-go-round and a Ferris wheel and that type of thing. It's still there, and it's still, you know, very radioactive. The thing that really hits home is you're in this city that once was 50,000 people, and there's not a sound. It is just absolute quiet, and you look and you see all these buildings that make you think city, but there's nothing there. And that's when it really hits home that what we have done to this part of the planet, and we're talking about an area the size of Switzerland, is rendered it permanently uninhabitable. And our planet does not have that many areas the size of Switzerland that we can render uninhabitable.
And not inhabitable for a month or a year, but
hundreds of years, at least, before people can live there again. And probably longer than that. You also have to remember that this area was once called, this is in the Ukraine, was once called the breadbasket of Europe. It was the main agricultural area for the former Soviet Union and would be now for Ukraine, except you can't grow anything there.
You've also been to into Europe and Germany, where there's been extremely active resistance to nuclear technology in recent years. But Germany in particular, tens of thousands of people have been involved in protests against nuclear waste transport. Describe the scene in Germany.
Well, Germany's interesting. Actually, I've been to Europe three times in the last 2 years to meet with activists and to visit and participate in some of these demonstrations. The reason being that as a result of the Kiev conference that I went to, NIRS, Nuclear Information Resource Service, began a new program focusing on Eastern Europe and the former Soviet states. And so the traveling has mostly been to, you know, meet with people from those areas. But I did have the opportunity in March of 1997 to witness the shipment of six casks of high-level radioactive waste from southern Germany to a small town called Gorleben, Germany. Now, much like in our own country, the German government a couple of decades ago chose Gorleben as the probable site for its permanent high-level nuclear waste dump. And what they want to do is bury this waste in a salt dome near this small farming village. However, for a variety of reasons, environmental reasons, opposition reasons, they have not been able to build an actual facility yet. So they have turned to what the United States is trying to turn to now, which is interim storage of this waste. And that basically means in Germany that they have built a small warehouse building to bring these casks in, mostly from the south where most of the nuclear plants are, and store them until such time as the permanent facility opens. And of course, if it never opens, then they will remain there in perpetuity. Well, the site was chosen because the German government believed at the time, 20 years ago, that this was a conservative area, it was a farming area, and that there would not be a lot of opposition to the nuclear projects the government had in mind. They were wrong. Just like everywhere else, the local population began questioning this, began organizing, and began working against this until the point that about 4 years ago, the Germans finally decided to move their first cask. And it was, nobody knew when it would happen. The government wasn't going to announce the day of the cask. So the local groups, you know, led by the farmers and the residents of the Gorleben area, put out a call for environmentalists across the country to appear at this place on day X. And X became the symbol of the movement. And when day X arrived, when the cask was seen leaving the reactor down south, about 2,500 people descended on this town and sat in the road to block the cask. And there were numerous arrests and that type of thing. A year later, it happened again with a second cask. When I was there, it was the third time they tried to ship, and it was six casks. And the setup is this. You have the cask travels by train very slowly throughout Germany, through the industrial midsection of the country, and it arrives in a small town called Dannenberg, which is where the tracks end. And there, these casks, and these are 100-ton casks, these are enormous things, each one carries the radiological equivalent of 200 Hiroshima bombs. They transfer these casks from a train to a truck and then bring it out from the transfer station to one of two small roads, two small two-lane roads. Well, when the casks arrived at this little town of Dannenberg this time, there were 9,000 people sitting in the road waiting for them, just sitting peacefully but not moving. And in fact, the slogan the Germans have adapted is, "We stand in the way." Along these two roads, these 14 miles from the station to the final endpoint, there were another 10 12,000 people at various points, blocking roads. The farmers in the area had taken about 80 of their tractors, locked their wheels together in the center of one road so that the cast couldn't get through the tractors. They had put up barricades. They had dug underneath the road to ensure that there was only one road the cast could go on. This last shipment was protected by 30,000 police. It was the largest mobilization of force in Germany since World War II. There were police the entire 200-mile stretch. There were thousands and thousands of police at Dannenberg and Gorleben. They were moving in convoys of 60, 80 trucks at a time. It does cost them. To get through these 9,000 people, they began at 1 o'clock in the morning arresting them individually, one by one. After 2 hours, they had cleared out 15 feet of roadway. So it was 30 degrees out. They turned on water cannons and started spraying the people. They started clubbing the people. They were 175 injuries. There were 500 arrests. And it took them 12 to 14 hours to clear this roadway. No other resistance among the demonstrators other than just locking arms and refusing to move until the police actually were able to move them. It's a very inspiring demonstration. The camps had been set up for several days. They do workshops, they do trainings, they do a lot of different types of things. It's a very inspiring movement. I mean, every little town in this region has its own what they call a burger initiative, which is their city initiative, and it's where the movement meets and gathers and connects.
Could talk about NIRS, the Nuclear Information and Resource Service. Now, 1998 is the 20th anniversary year of NIRS. The group is based in Washington. How did it get started? What does it do? How can viewers out there get involved in the activities of the work of NIRS?
We call ourselves the Information and Networking Center for environmental groups and, you know, normal people, for the media, interested in nuclear power, radioactive waste, and sustainable energy issues generally, about radiation issues generally. It's actually sort of an interesting that the founding, I was not there then. There was a gentleman, a metals millionaire, manganese millionaire actually, named Stanley Weiss, in the late 1970s, became interested in the anti-nuclear movement, and, you know, obviously he had a little money. And he took a trip around the country, meeting with different activist groups across the country, asking, well, what do you need? What do you need? And the answer that he got back regularly was, we need a presence in Washington. We need the information from Washington to come back out to us. We need we need an information and networking center. And he came back to Washington and founded it. And he stayed about a year and then left and went on to do something else. That's been really our core function ever since. I mean, that we monitor the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, the Department of Energy, Congress, the White House, all the different agencies that are located in Washington, try to get the information from these places and get them to the people across the country who are interested in this, who need to know this, who may want to use it. We try to let people know about upcoming congressional votes that they may want to participate in or try to influence one way or the other. We try to let people know about important rules changes that they may want to comment upon in the public comment process. We also try to monitor, with the help of grassroots groups across the country, all the different power plants, to know what's happening at all of them, all the potential radioactive waste sites, that type of thing. In recent years, though, we've also, you know, besides doing this core function, we've also expanded our mission a little bit to do what we consider fairly aggressive organizing campaigns on specific issues. We have a program now in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union countries where we provide grants to grassroots groups working in those countries to fight what really are the most dangerous nuclear reactors of all, the old Soviet reactors. We also have an intern program with the East. We working on ways, you know, particularly through the internet, to be able to provide the same type of assistance to those groups that we provide to groups here. We're also serving as their watchdog and their eye on Washington with institutions like the Export-Import Bank and the State Department. We are, in fact, we are filming this, taping this at the, as you mentioned, at the Northeast Action Camp, which was another major NEARS project, which we're doing with the, in conjunction with the Citizens Awareness Network, which is called the Nuclear Free New England Campaign. And this is one part of this campaign, where we're having a week-long training session, week-long what we call Action Camp, which is a training session for activists from across New England, training them in the issues, in organizational development, organizing, nonviolence training, this type of thing. And the camp's being accompanied by a rally, a large rally we had in downtown Brattleboro a couple of days ago. A few days from this taping, there will be a demonstration at the gates of Vermont Yankee with civil disobedience. But it's an ongoing campaign. It doesn't end with this camp. It's something that the people being trained here will then go across New England over the next several months, using their new skills to build new coalitions in their communities and to bring up the issue in their communities. Because our goal really is to make New England the nation's first nuclear-free region, to make New England the nation's first or the nation's model of sustainable energy practices. And we think we're getting a real good start here, but it's an ongoing campaign. It's one that's going to continue. The Action Camp idea, however, also has caught on, and now we're getting requests from other parts of the country to bring this whole concept to other parts of the country. So we'll be looking into that over the next year. These are some of the types of things that NEARS does on a daily basis. Another big program we have, and we're at this point we're the only national group in the country doing this, is work on the issue of low-level radioactive waste. Working to help communities faced with the prospect of a low-level radioactive waste dump in their neighborhood, Ward Valley, California, near Needles, California, where it's a sacred Native American land. We've been working with environmental groups and Native groups to fight that project. North Carolina, Nebraska, a couple other states where they're trying to build these new dumps and contaminate new places that haven't been contaminated before. And people always tell me, well, the waste has to go somewhere, doesn't it? And I say, well, it is somewhere. And this also gets back to the whole mobile Chernobyl and transport issue. Why? I don't understand the ethics that allow somebody to think, well, I can make this lethal garbage and I can send it to somebody else 300 miles away or 3,000 miles away and it's okay. Because it's not okay. I can't take my personal garbage and throw over the fence in my neighbor's yard, and yet these companies think they can take lethal garbage and put it on our highways, put it on our railways, and put it on a poor Hispanic community 2,400 miles away. I don't understand the ethics of that, and I don't think most Americans do either.
The great irony of nuclear power, I think, in the late 1990s, is there's no need for it. In fact, the great advances in so-called alternative, safe, renewable energy technologies have rendered nuclear power, just moot in terms of a need. Could you speak on that issue, Michael?
Well, sure. Nuclear power is used to create electricity. I mean, that's what it's for. There are other ways to create electricity, and some of them are, there's no way that's environmentally benign, but some of them are actually pretty good. Wind power, for example, is the fastest growing power source in the country today and in the world today. And there was a study, even as far back as it was about 1982, 83, where the Department of Energy determined that in the state of South Dakota alone, there's enough wind power capability to power the entire country for the foreseeable future. The only problem being the transmission lines, of course. But there's huge potential for wind power, and it's cost competitive with any other power source at this point. And in fact, we're increasingly seeing utilities building ever larger and larger wind plants. I mean, a few years ago, they were building 5 megawatts at a time. Now they're building 50 to 75 megawatts at a time. And over the next few years, we're expecting orders of hundreds of megawatts at a time. a lot of the power that nuclear power plants, as they close, and they are closing, will be replaced with is wind. Energy efficiency is, of course, the best method of creating electricity of all, because what it does is it reduces demand for electricity. And we've had just tremendous advantages in energy efficiency in things like refrigerators, industrial motors, lighting, to the point where each dollar spent on energy efficiency is 7 times more effective at removing greenhouse gases, the carbon dioxide that the coal and oil plants emit, than is a dollar spent on nuclear power. It's cheaper to build a nuclear plant, it's cheaper to close a nuclear power plant that has just been built and replace its power with energy efficiency than it is to actually run the plant, even if the plant had cost nothing to build. And that's where we're at with energy efficiency now. And these things are real, they're happening. But the other thing about all this is citizens, one of the questions NIRS gets a lot is that citizens say, it seems hopeless, you know, what can you do? The nuclear industry is so big. Well, you know, people power works. You know, I've seen it work overseas. I've seen it work in this country in a lot of movements. You know, remember that we were going to build 1,000 reactors in this country by the year 2000. We're going to have less than 100. Most of those reactors were stopped because the public said no. And one of the things that we're trying to instill at the New England Action Camp here is this sense that citizen involvement, citizen participation, and citizen action can and will make a difference, because we honestly believe it. In the 1990s, 4 nuclear reactors in New England have closed, all for the same confluence of reasons: safety problems, economic problems, radioactive waste problems, and strong citizen opposition. It's what we're teaching at this camp, and it's really a message of hope. Citizens can change things. We believe that at NIRS, and if people want to join in with us at that, our phone number is 202-328-0002, and you can check our website at www.nirs.org.
Michael Marriott, Executive Director of the Nuclear Information and Resource Service, the leading organization in the United States, watchdogging, disseminating information, being there to just closely monitor the state of nuclear technology in the U.S. today. Michael Marriott, Executive Director of NIRS, thank you for your work. I'm Carl Grossman. This has been Enviro Close-Up. Thank you for watching.